takes note that the time is now 7 o'clock. Also that the necessary number of members are present for the necessary quorum. Therefore, the meeting of the Board of Zoning Appeals of the Town of Farragut come to order. The first item of business is the approval of the minutes of the February 25th, 2015 meeting. And voting on these minutes, I will not be voting because I was absent. We have a new member and he should not vote on this, okay? So the remaining three members may vote. Do I have a recommendation?
So moved, they approved.
Okay, I have a second. Those in favor of approving the minutes say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, approved by the. Second item on the agenda is a public hearing on a request for a setback and buffer strip width variance for the property located to the west of Village Veterinary and to the east of the former Phillips 66 on Kingston Pike, parcel 131 map, tax map 142, zone 01 and OSP. Craig Allen is the applicant. Is Mr. Allen present?
Yes.
Thank you. Welcome. We'll call on you to speak later, okay?
Okay. I don't have to say much.
Just be available. We have a guest, I guess.
Yeah, let me just give an overview here, I guess. And don't let me forget, I've got a few reminders at the end of this meeting about some upcoming training sessions that we have, besides the one tonight.
Staff have anything to say?
I can just go over what my write-up was in the packet if that would be helpful, and we've got some pictures and things. I don't know if y'all have had a chance to go out to try to look at the property. It's a 16-acre tract that's between the Farragut High School. There's a football practice field there to the east, and then of course those businesses that run along Campbell Station Road to the west, and the western portion of the property is in the floodplain, and it's actually zoned open space park. And the applicant is coming before you this evening to request basically to have a flexible buffer strip, which would also affect the setback requirements for structures on this property. That is the property itself. And that's kind of an aerial image showing the juxtaposition of the property in relation to the school, and then the condition of the property. You can see that there's kind of a cleared area along the western edge of the property. That's First Utility District, sanitary sewer easement through there. And at some point there will be, a walking trail that will connect kind of, on that western edge. It'd have to be out of the floodway, of course. But anyway, that's kind of an aerial image of what the property would look like. What they're requesting is to provide for, let me just go to their concept drawing. Again, this is just the concept for this particular request. They have not had any plans approved yet. But what they're requesting is to have up to a 90-foot buffer area from the western property line. That's on the lower part of the screen there.
Point that out, Mark.
Huh?
Where are you pointing to on that?
The green
green area only?
Lower.
lower green area.
Yeah, well, this is related to this request. I don't know why this is not working.
The lower part of the screen is the buffer area that they're wanting to be wider than what would be required in the upper part that abuts the school property. They're wanting to lessen the buffer. The property is currently zoned office. And in the office zoning district, they're required to have a 25-foot buffer where it abuts property zoned residential. But the applicant is currently in the process of pursuing a rezoning for this property, for the office portion of this property, in order to construct a mixed-use town center, kind of based on that layout there. Again, that's just conceptual, but that's generally what he's got in mind. And if the property were rezoned to the town center district, there would be a 35-foot buffer strip required around the periphery of the property. You know, that abuts the portion that's zoned residential. The school property to the east is actually zoned residential, but it's obviously not a residential development. So what the effect of the request for this flexibility in the buffer strip would be that, you know, a structure could be, what they're requesting is to go to up to 20-foot buffer strip on the east end that abuts the school, as opposed to the 35 feet. So it's a 15-foot variation. In the town center district, there's a 40-foot peripheral setback for any structures. And that's buildings or anything basically other than signs or fences has to be out of that 40 feet. So if we reduced the buffer area and the setback by 15 feet, then, you know, there would be an encroachment into that peripheral setback area as well. So if the buffer strip were reduced from 35 to 20 feet, there would in effect be a 20-foot setback variance granted for that 40-foot peripheral setback for structures, if that makes sense. So there's actually two things that would be affected by this request. The reason they're requesting this is to try to save some of the larger trees that are down on that western end, you know, where the creek is, and that abuts the town's outdoor classroom property. You know, they're, so, I mean, we certainly support their efforts to try to widen that buffer and to provide a more natural transition between this property and their development to the outdoor classroom. It also gives them a good, more of a noise and visual buffer from Campbell Station Road for their development. And since the property to the east, the school property, is not a residential development, their argument for the relief is, and the tree quality is not quite as good on that portion of the property. They feel that the intent of the buffer requirement would be better realized with this request. Now, there are some substantial trees that I couldn't really tell exactly, but it looks like they're pretty close to the property line up there. I'm going to go, well, this is looking at the property from that practice football field on the school property, and you're looking into Mr. Allen's property. There's some pretty large trees that appear to be right on the property line. If you maintained a 20-foot buffer strip there, you know, it's not ideal. It would be better to have a bigger buffer, but, you know, the trees that are on the property line would not be, you know, disturbed. They could have some encroachment into their drip line just because of their size. That's another picture a little further away, but it does show that there are some, you know, pretty good tree growth on that border. Now, this is the tree survey in the upper part. Those dots represent relatively large trees, and you can see they're kind of concentrated along that property line on the top of the screen there. On the lower part, you can kind of see where, you know, there's kind of a concentration of trees, you know, kind of in that area that abuts the outdoor classroom. So that would be, you know, something to think about when we're looking at the flexibility in this zoning district is what, that's what the tree cover looks like in the transition area between the outdoor classroom. You can see it on the right side of the screen there. And then Mr. Allen's property to the left. So it's a pretty good quality of tree cover there that they're trying to, you know, give a better chance for protection by moving that, you know, increasing that buffer in that area. The question, you know, that comes before the board anytime a request for relief is comes to you all is whether, you know, all measures have been taken to try to minimize or avoid, you know, the relief in the first place. I would like to see some measures taken that would try to lessen the footprint of the parking on the site. What would be encroaching in that 15 feet of buffer strip that would be altered if the variance were granted would be a parking garage structure. Wouldn't be any buildings per se, occupied buildings, but it would be a parking garage structure. You know, the question that I always have, you know, once one of these matters comes before you is, again, you know, whether there could be some measures taken that would lessen the degree of variance or nullify the need for the variance in the first place. We certainly support and, you know, and appreciate the applicant trying to provide a much wider buffer than would be required on the lower part of the property that abuts the outdoor classroom. My question is, where those trees abutting the school property are actually situated, and if relief is granted on that buffer strip, would those relatively large trees be compromised by the action? And are there ways in which to lessen the footprint of the parking? We've tried to lower the parking requirements for this use. There'll be amendments going through the Board of Mayor and Aldermen in early August for ordinance to lower the parking space requirements for residential units in this development. So, I mean, we're hoping that that can help to lessen the footprint of parking on the site. If variance is granted as requested by the applicant in this case, I think it needs to be clear that it would be conducted only to provide a significantly larger buffer than would otherwise be required. And then also the rather unusual context of an adjacent property that's zoned residential, but it's not developed as residential. One of the reasons we have the buffer strips in the town is to protect residents, you know, from an adjoining use that they may perceive as being incompatible. You know, if the adjacent use is ball fields, it, you know, you could argue that there's a difference there. And then also that, you know, obviously the trees, if they are on the property line, that they be preserved and protected in that adjusted buffer. And that any areas that aren't tree covered, be planted to the specifications of the 35-foot wide buffer strip, which is what would be required without relief in this case, so that in effect, the plant material per 100 linear feet of buffer strip would actually be the same number of units that you would have if the full 35-foot buffer were still intact. And you can do that. We've done it on some other projects. The material obviously is a little closer together, and you have to be more careful with what you're selecting, but it certainly can be done. So that's kind of an overview of this request. There's a lot of things going on. I've got some photographs, and we also have the full plans if anybody wants to see, you know, a larger version of what they're proposing. And I know Mr. Allen can speak to
a couple of questions for you. Has this been before the Planning Commission and the board to be approved?
Well, the only thing that what the Planning Commission has reviewed up till now is the applicant has asked them to look at a couple of provisions in the Town Center Zoning District. One of them was dealing with parking requirements. The other was dealing with signage, and the Planning Commission has, at their meeting last week, 18th of June, recommended favorably toward the applicant's request, and it'll be going to the Board of Mayor and Aldermen in August. There has not been a concept plan approved, or the property has not been rezoned yet either to the Town Center District.
That has to be done by the Mayor and Alderman?
Yes. Yes, it would have to be. What we're waiting on before we take the rezoning request to the Planning Commission is a traffic impact study for the project.
If we here approve this, are we setting a precedent?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, there are a couple of things that you have in this request that you could argue would be very different from some of the other buffer strip situations. The applicant would be providing more of a buffer in one area, and then you also have a situation where an adjoining property is zoned residential, but it's not been developed as residential. It's, you know, a school with ball fields. So that may, you know, be points that you could use to say this is how this is different than.
So we would be setting a precedent.
Could be. You can always be setting a precedent with any action you take. Like I say, I'd like to lessen that variance request a little bit if possible, or even nullify it. The tree quality, as far as I can tell, on the upper part, other than right along the property line, there are some open areas in Mr. Allen's property. Once you get away from that kind of that fence line, that tree line that abuts the ball fields on the school property.
I don't think it's been mentioned. What is this building project mainly for? Apartments?
It's a mixed-use development. So it would be the first. It's up to four-story buildings, four of them. And the first floor would be non-residential. It would have to be office or retail. And then the non-ground floors could be, you know, residential or office. So it's just a mixed-use type of development. What it is just an effort to develop a mixed-use town center for the town, which is one of the goals, the most important strategy in our comprehensive plan update that we updated in December of 2012. The feedback that we received from the public during the development of that document is that they wanted to have the town work toward developing downtown for Farragut, because it doesn't have that kind of core area, that identity that older communities have, kind of a central gathering place that you can recognize as being the town of Farragut. It just kind of is a series of shopping centers and subdivisions right now, but it doesn't have that real developed core. So that's what this would be an attempt to try to do. And it's not just on this property, it's other properties, in and around the town hall could be candidates. This could be a first step, maybe a section of a town center. There could be other sections and other areas near the town hall that could also be good candidates or could dovetail onto what they're trying to do on this property. This is a project that obviously very likely will take many years and and a number of phases, I would think. It's obviously a big capital investment, what he's looking at doing.
Have you all given any consideration, and this is not what we're here to do, but it's part of this. If we approve this, we're essentially approving this plan, but it looks to me like you got a traffic nightmare.
Well, that's what we're waiting on, is a traffic impact study for this concept.
Red lights every 100 feet.
Well, it will have an impact. There's no doubt about it. And we're not really approving this concept. This variance is going with the land. It's only dealing with the land itself and how the buffer strips and peripheral setback would apply in the areas that are shaded in green there on the screen.
Mr. Shipley, I need to ask you a few questions that are on the outside of my knowledge of trees.
Okay.
I understand from tree specialist and arborist that when we talk about the drip line, we're talking about the outermost branch from a tree from which rain drips, basically. So if you have the trunk of a tree, the trunk of a big tree could be 2 feet, could be 4 feet, could be 5 feet if it was quite a big tree. But the drip line is how far the branches extend out to the edge.
Yeah, the edge of the canopy, basically, yeah.
All right. Also have something to do with the roots?
Well, the drip line doesn't. And that was the point that I was getting to. If you look at Exhibit D, we have a bunch of circles at the bottom of Exhibit D, which I assume represent the drip line of larger trees in that area.
Oh, down the lower part, yes.
Yes. In what's supposed to be the larger, almost 90-foot extended buffer. Now, the drip line does not indicate the extent of the roots. My understanding from tree specialists is that the root line of a larger tree actually extends up to 60 feet off the drip line, and that when we're talking about a tree with a drip line as substantial as some of these trees, that if you get into the root system, which can be up to 60 feet off the drip line, because obviously the whole goal of the roots is to get water, and they have to extend beyond the tree because the tree is, to some extent, diverting the water off of the tree. That's why the roots are out beyond the drip line. And so when you get into the root structure beyond the drip line, you're killing these trees anyway. And so if you're building a large parking garage within 60 feet of beyond the drip line, which some of these obviously would be in there, some of the drip lines are where the parking garage is, and essentially those trees are goners anyway. And we have no trees at all displayed in a similar drip line fashion on the reduced buffer zone. So I have no idea where the drip line is on any of those, and I have no idea what the extension beyond that would be. But if you're telling me that there are some substantial trees, and you gave me some pictures of substantial trees that are there off the Farragut baseball field, you're telling me that there's a reduction to 20 feet. I mean, the drip line of some of those trees is going to be 20 feet, let alone the actual root system is going to exist far beyond that. And once you dig down and excavate into the root system, you're just going to kill those trees too. So, I mean, basically, if you reduce that buffer to 20 feet, you're going to kill all those trees anyway.
Well, it's hard to answer that question, and roots are varied depending on many different conditions, species of the tree, the characteristics of the soil, all kinds of things that can, and some trees are more resistant to stress than others. But yeah, that's a concern, and I pointed that out in the introduction that there are some sizable trees along what appears to be the property line between Craig's property and the school. And again, if you look at this screen, this is a tree inventory for this project, and you can see a lot of dots kind of right on that property line on the upper part of the screen. And some of those trees are pretty substantial. If you reduce the buffer strip width by 15 feet, it could make the difference with a number of those trees. It could.
Do we have any drawings, diagrams, anything before us that shows us the drip line on the buffer area that is proposed to be reduced to 20 feet? I have what appears to be the drip line on the part that's closest to Campbell Station, but I don't have a drip line on any trees for the other side, which is the one we're trying to reduce.
Yeah, well,
straight.
Yeah. Oh, that's a very good question, yeah. I have not seen one.
My comment on it would be, if I'm looking at this right here, and I have to assume that the red line is the property line.
I'll go back to that on the screen.
Mark, it would seem to me that we're overall a little premature on this until the other board and the mayor and aldermen get done with what they have to do in the way of rezoning and everything else. It would seem to me that we should wait for them to get their work done and then have the developer come back in with the proposal.
Well, that could be a suggestion. The reason it's here before you tonight is that with the town center district, unlike most other rezonings, you actually have to have a concept plan presented with the rezoning request. And I think what we advise Mr. Allen, and he's just acting on our advice, is that he might need some direction on this buffer situation so that he knew how to present his concept plan as part of the rezoning. So that's why it's here. But certainly if more information is needed, or you all aren't ready or comfortable with acting on it as presented, then you certainly have that prerogative to make that call. And I agree with Keith that I don't really know where the trees, the substantial, and maybe they're all on the school property over there on the east side. It's hard to tell. I would probably rely on the Batson and Hines survey, but then it would certainly be helpful to try to get an indication of what the, at a minimum, the canopy extent would be and how that could be affected by reduction of the buffer strip in that location. I can tell you that most of the time in developing, most of what we ask people to do is to fence off out to the drip line. Now, Keith is entirely correct that roots on most trees go, in some cases, way beyond the drip line. But the protection zone that most arborists recommend as a compromise. In an ideal world, it would be great to go out to wherever we feel that the roots might be so that you don't have to sever the roots. But at a minimum, most trees, can make it if you stay out completely out of their drip line. You may have to, if you're in a cut situation, what you would want to do is define the cut limit area, and then you'd want to come in and cleanly saw the tree roots along that cut line before you started doing any excavation. So that it's, because it's the tugging of the roots on the trees that causes them more stress than if you were to just go out there with an arborist surgical saw and saw those tree roots along that cut line before you started. Now, that's what we would recommend. That's a process called root pruning, and that's commonly used and commonly recommended by arborists. Arborists understand in the urban setting or suburban setting that there's always going to be that conflict between development and trees. You know, it's unfortunate. I'm a tree hugger, unapologetic tree hugger. I like to save as many as I can. But I also understand that you just got to try to do the best you can and reach some middle ground. And if they can maintain the cut outside of the drip line, then I would feel that for many trees, unless they're already stressed, would have a decent chance of survival. It's likely on that property that he has a lot of hackberry trees, that'd be my guess, and probably black cherry. As those are oftentimes just trees that come up over time, and those are generally pretty resistant to stress. There are some trees that are real sensitive to stress, some certain types of oaks, for example, but I don't know that he's got a lot of that in those locations. So I think if he could do something to where they stayed out of the drip line, you know, whether that's where the 20 feet gives him the ability to do that or not, is a good question. It's a question that probably needs to be answered. Then I think that would be what I would try for, is just to stay out of the drip line.
That red line is the property line. It looks like the bulk of the tree, or the dark brown portion of the...
Not on it.
Of that property line.
Hard to tell. To me, it looks like they're right on the property line, but.
Well, if I go south, there's very little over on the side next to the track.
Yes.
As I go up toward, as I go north, I guess that would be.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Then it looks like there's more, a little bit more.
Or on the line, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But then as you get up in the very northwest corner, the bulk of it's over on the school property.
Where's your northwest corner you're talking about?
Right here.
That's east.
It's north up here. This is east over here. West is over there. South down here.
Well, I'm going north and I'm headed west. I'm not headed east. It looks like the bulk of the trees are over on the school property, which would be the corner by the school access road and up near the football practice field. So if you're coming 20 feet that way, or 40 feet that way,
yeah.
Or 35, I guess it is.
Yeah, 35 would be the buffer.
Yeah, that's quite a bit.
The setback would be 40 feet. So, if in effect, the non-disturbance area would be 40 feet.
40 feet.
Yeah, because he'd have to keep all his structures 40 feet off of that eastern property line.
That's going to catch most of the drip line. I went up and looked at it, and the best.
Yeah.
I could.
Yes. It's hard to tell where the property line is. Yeah.
It's hard to tell because you really don't know. You can't stretch
the line
for the property line, but
yes.
What I did was kind of look from the, based on this piece of paper that you sent us, I looked from where that tree line come down back behind the castle.
Yeah.
And across, and I just assumed that had to be pretty much the center of the property line.
I'd say that's pretty accurate.
And walked over to the veterinarian clinic and kind of looked the same way. and it looks like the bulk of the trees are actually on Mr. Allen's property, but particularly on that end, on the south end.
Yeah.
Mark, overall, listening to what all has been said, it seems to me that we got the cart before the horse on this thing. It seems that we are trying to develop the land or plan the land use to fit the project instead of the project being planned to fit the land. Now, we are bound by a certain rule set forth by the state on what we can and cannot approve in the way of variances.
Yes.
One thing they say is that it does not warrant a variance is something that is just a personal preference, and that's exactly what this is. I don't think this board has the authority under those rules to approve this request.
Well, that's...
There's one other thing added to that, and that is that this is really setting a precedent beyond anything else that I've seen since we've been on this board.
Well, I'd love to see this project go in, but I think it needs some replanning. And I'm surprised that the organization who did this planning for you did not become aware of the restrictions and the boundaries and such as that before they laid out a hard plan.
Well, I think they're aware of it, and they, you know, we've been discussing the buffer with Mr. Allen for quite some time, and we were trying to get more of a buffer along that western edge, you know, because of the transition. It's kind of a natural area along the creek there, the North Fork and Turkey Creek. But I agree with you. I'm, you know, after looking at the tree line abutting the school up there, I'm a little bit, I'm certainly concerned about where, in fact, those trees are located and what would be the impact of reducing the buffer in that along that property line.
What concerns me most, and to give you some direction, is that if we're making this a conversation about conserving trees, and the rationale for the variance would be that the school is not a residential district and it's not being used properly, then to show us the drip line of the trees in the expanded area is great. Please do that. That's showing us what will be saved. But then to not show us any of the trees in the area that you're looking to reduce as far as the drip line seems potentially misleading, because we don't have any information other than us guessing at this point what's on one side or where things are.
Well, you can come on my property and look at it, but the excavation is not on that end at all, because that land is the topo is a natural. It's already at the lower level of the garage on the northeast end. So none of those trees, there's really no excavation there. When you come down to the artificial turf, there are no trees. That's an open space. They actually the Farragut High School knocked down the trees that were on my property to build their practice field.
Can you show me where you're talking about? Can you, I don't know what's the easiest way. Do you have something
right
you can point to? Okay. So when you say you can come down to the property, I mean, it's difficult to walk at the property and determine.
No, it's not.
Okay.
Yeah, that's pretty easy.
But I mean, as far as to tell where the trees are and where the boundary is exactly?
It's very easy.
Okay. Well, show me what you got.
If you look at these topos, see, you're 10 foot below. So this right here is a naturally, this area right here is naturally at the level of the parking, of the lower level parking.
Mm-hmm.
So there is no excavation. You're only talking about 15 feet. So it's not going to change the drip line that much one way or the other, because under the town center zone, I can go to 35 feet.
Sure.
So you're talking about 15 feet and what that does. I've done a lot of excavation around trees that are within 10 feet of them and they never die. So not huge trees.
Sure. I mean, the problem is I've litigated a lot of cases around huge trees where they've gotten within 60 feet of the drip line and they've killed them. So that's...
Well, they're my trees.
Sure. Well, and you can kill whatever you want to. I mean, if you If you have 35 feet and you decide to dig to China and want to kill all the roots and all these trees, you're free to do that.
That's
your right. But if you're asking us to reduce that, then we're taking on some of the responsibility for what's killed and what's not killed. And
you know,
I don't.
What side do you want to kill? Don't you want to kill? Well, that would help.
Sure, I don't know.
So, do you want them killed down here where you've got a platform, or up here where there is nothing that it affects? And as far as said in the present, there is no other piece of property in Farragut that has this same situation where you have a, where you're against the school. It's like this.
See, that is it, may, Mr. Allen. We're putting the cart before the horse, as Mr. Ives said. None of this has been approved. The traffic study hasn't been. And so we're asked to approve this, not knowing that this whole thing has been, yeah, you can go ahead with it. So if we do this and they turn it all down, then we got to come back again. But if we prove this, we're essentially saying, hey, this is okay, go ahead and do it. And that's my problem.
Yeah.
It's got to be going, you got to go to the Planning Commission and the Board of Mayor and Aldermen,
well,
and you got to have a traffic study.
Well,
yeah, no, but we don't have that. And that's not part of our dealing here, but our dealing is for this buffer zone thing.
Right.
But that has a limitation for what we can do.
There will be a concept approved, and so it'll be null and void. I won't come back because there will be a concept that will be approved at 35 feet. And what we're trying to do, because that's the rule under a county center. So what the idea was trying to save areas around classroom and get away from the creek a little farther, so to make everything still fit on the property. And as far as the parking is, the footprint's not going to change because the level of parking that's required for the office and commercial has to be what it is. I mean, that part's not changing.
Mm-hmm.
That's we're not asking for a change under the commercial part. The only thing that's going to be changing.
No, well, that's not part of our to do, but it fits in. Our thinking.
Well, no, it is, because once the plan's submitted, then if there's not a variance, then it'll be the way it was, and so you're going to be knocking out these trees down here that we're trying to say.
So you're asking for a variance with the reasoning that when it goes to the Board of Aldermen to be approved, has it been approved by the Planning Commission?
Well, what he's as I mentioned earlier, when you rezone property to the Town Center District, unlike most other zoning districts, you actually have to have a concept plan with that rezoning request. So what he's trying to get some guidance on is how the concept plan should be laid out. And that's why he's looking at these buffer, the more flexibility in the buffer to provide a greater one on the lower end there, the west end, and then a less one on the east side.
Surely the Planning Commission got enough sense to not approve the project when they know it's going to violate the boundaries.
Well, I mean, they wouldn't be.
Violate the boundaries unless.
If it's denied here, he'll just have to meet the requirements of the Town Center District. And that's fine. That's your all's prerogative. And or if you don't have enough good information, you certainly have the prerogative to either postpone it or.
It won't come back. No. Once if it goes before the Board of Aldermen, the concept will be approved. It won't come back to you guys.
He would only come back to you if he needs to vary from some requirement.
If I understand correctly, you'll be then 35 feet from all the buffers, and that just moves you over closer to these trees and to the water. Yeah. Do you have anything at all, and what I was getting at, maybe I wasn't clear, that shows me the larger trees on, I guess this is the east side, with the drip line on them? I mean, they've gone to trouble to show me the drip line on down here. Is there any drawing that you have with you that shows me any trees that are up here of significance?
No, and I'm not sure. Are these the drip lines that
they appear to be?
Put in?
Well, they're rough, approximate.
I think that was adding some trees there, too.
No, I think that's the drip line of some of the larger identified trees.
Mark, can you pull up that, the one that had all the dots of the trees on it?
Yeah, uh-huh.
This is a good one, if you can see that.
Yeah, those full-size sheets are a little easier to see.
May I share this with him?
Well, there clearly are some large...
Here's what I want to look at.
Yes. I think I've got this thing working here.
That's on his property, right?
Well, some of them, it looked like a lot of them are right on the property line. Some of the trunks do appear to be, some of them on his property.
Where would be the normal buffer zone line on that map?
For the town center district, it's a 35-foot buffer.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, if you can share that with everyone.
This is the way it's submitted right now.
But that's the way it will have to be sold as the concept if we don't grant a variance, is what you're saying.
And then there won't be a need, once that's approved, and there won't be a need for a variance.
You wouldn't come back before us because you've already met the requirements. Sure, you don't need a variance.
The variance is intended to save more trees on the western border where there's more, potentially more impact. I don't see the impact between the end of school.
I have to agree with you on that because there's the impact up here, there's nothing going on. We're down here, you've got the classroom. You have the, that open area, you've got the fire department, you've got, four businesses down through here before you get up to where Phillips 66 is at.
Well, a lot of that'll have to be undisturbed because it's in the floodplain, you know, obviously.
So really, you're moving it to where there's more room around the creek and the floodplain area.
He's just shifting the buffer so that there's a greater, you know, quite a bit greater buffer on the lower part, but less of one on the upper part.
And the idea is that when the larger buffer is created, that there will be a walking trail following the creek or the...
It'll be, you know, in the flood fringe portion of the property.
Here it is here.
You're looking
at it on here.
More trees.
It'll basically be on the western portion, and it'll tie into the outdoor classroom property. Yeah.
It's way up here.
There's nothing there now.
Here.
It's here in this map. That's a different map. That's the way it was submitted, and this is the difference.
This is the way it's submitted, and this is what he's asking.
Now, the buffer will be here. All this.
My property line right there.
Right here.
So where would the buffer be? Where are all the trees?
20 feet.
Right here.
What's over here?
The trees are along here. This is, the practice field is right about here.
Yeah, there's...
But there...
There's a soccer field.
This is his line, so these are the trees all in here.
Mm-hmm.
These will be trees in here, and whatever trees are over here.
And I'll be adding trees, because this is actually right through here. There are no trees.
Yeah, it's a big open area. Right here's the big open area that I saw when I was up there.
Yeah. I mean, you can actually, if you drive, you can actually walk the whole, I've just mowed it. You can walk the whole piece of property right there.
I don't know.
I stood right here and I looked down through here, and then I stood right here and looked down through here, assuming that that's
where this is the property line. Where's the property line? Here or here? This is the property line that he has.
This hard line.
What are your thoughts?
Yeah. Here, it's right here.
Mark, I've got a question. If we approve it,
I mean, that's
to there. What is he moving to there?
The whole
long run.
Buildings, you mean? Everything over there?
Obviously,
zoning.
Water down.
It goes over to here.
Zoning.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That now, when you look at this, that's over here. So you got 20 feet in there.
No, I agree. Yeah.
Which would be
kind of just, it's the back school.
It's here.
Question when he's finished here, so everybody can hear it. Let me see.
But we've still got a total of 40 feet, correct?
No, you don't.
Well, the periphery setback, the setback to the nearest structure is 40 feet.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
So we've got 40 feet.
Yes. Yes, that's right. In the town center.
Here's what structure, the parking?
Yeah, the town center district has a 40-foot peripheral. Yeah, I mean, if you granted the variance, I mean, it would, you would be, you'd have basically a 20-foot variance on that.
Be 20 up here and you'd be 60 here?
You'd be almost 90.
90, wow, okay.
That's what the plan shows, is around 90 feet.
Gentlemen, the only, Mr. Ives and I were talking, and the only legitimate reason for granting a variance in this instance that I can see is because it would be based on the fact that the school is zoned residential. It is not in fact being used residential, and the 35-foot setback is really in anticipation of the budding a residential use. Is that accurate, Mark, or not?
Yeah, I think generally the buffer strips in the town have been created as a protection with intent to protect residents. I mean, that...
If it was zoned residential by the board, by the mayor and board, would this boundary be okay to that type of zoning? Or are they still going to be in violation?
I don't follow your question. What are you talking about?
You mean if it was actually houses there for you?
No. When the mayor and alderman, they're going
to... They approve this plan.
...rezone this thing, and recognizing what the school there, that sets some restrictions on the boundary.
Well, as part of that rezoning, the concept plan, which would reflect whatever is agreed on with the buffer, would be presented to them as part of that rezoning request. They could deny the rezoning request if they had a problem with the concept plan, certainly.
But the variance would run with the land. So even if they turned it down, once we grant the variance, then they've got a 20-foot
exactly right.
buffer on one side, and even if 90, they don't go through with this entire project.
And a 90-foot one on the other side. That's exactly right, and that's a very good point, because the variances typically run with the land, not a project.
In that case, would that much boundary be commensurate with the current requirements for this type of project?
Well, the boundary on the west end would be much greater than what would be required, 35 versus 90. But then the boundary on the east side, the budding school, would be 15 feet less than what would be required for the buffer, and then 20 feet less for the peripheral setback. It's short of 20 feet on the setback, and it's short 15 feet on the buffer in the area abutting the school, the eastern property line.
And this is also one other thing to consider. Are we setting a precedent here, as I brought up first?
Well, that's up to you all to decide. I think the points have been made. I think there are some distinctions, you know, you can use for this property, given its context and what's the surrounding plan of development, and then also the effort of trying to save more trees in a more environmentally sensitive area and provide a substantially greater buffer than would be required, might be some things to think about.
That area is more of a environmental sensitive area. I would think so.
Yeah, I mean, you got the floodplain down there. But I think it's certainly a valid question to know where those trees are on that property line, on the eastern property, and that's a big concern of mine. I mean, I'd hate to, even though there's a school there, you know, if reducing the buffer would lead to the removal of a lot, or the death of a lot of those trees, they'll have to be protected during the project. But oftentimes the stress caused to trees is not seen for 2 or 3 years after the completion of the project. And if proper measures aren't taken during the construction, then, you know, you could, they could start seeing trees die and trees having to be removed and that kind of thing, you know.
You get the developer could go in there and whack them down anyway.
No, no, you would have to, you'd have to, you're going to have a buffer strip there of some width, and you cannot disturb any existing non-invasive tree cover. Now, you may have some vines and privet and things that someone could come in by hand and under the approval by the town, thin it out, but you could not go in and cut down tree cover in an existing buffer strip.
That is a tricky one, because if we saw value to increasing the environmentally sensitive area, we then can get an almost 90-foot buffer area that otherwise that we have no legitimate reason to impose on this property. But the concern is we're almost certainly going to lose whatever buffer there is on the school side, which, you know, albeit might not be as valuable, and you could theoretically plant things if you lost those to have some amount of buffer.
I mean, 20 feet is just a little bit more than the depth of a parking space, so it's not a lot of distance.
Leland cypress probably needs more than 20 feet if it's that big in the center. I'm not real sure, but I've seen some pretty big Leland cypresses, and that's a pretty fast-growing buffer. Yeah,
I'm concerned about the lack of information on that eastern property line.
That is my primary concern. I'm interested in the discussion and interested in continuing it. I would like to see more information, and I understand if it's not cost-effective for the developer to get us more information, because that would require someone to go out and give us the drip line of some bigger trees, but that is the information I wish I had.
Yes.
You'd want to identify them too. I mean, if they're oaks or maples or hackberries or
sure.
Poplar or, you know, the type of tree, but.
Yep.
It does identify those. Yeah, those are identified on the larger plan. You can't see it on that sheet, but the actual full-size plan, I think, has.
On the school side, the eastern side?
It has the names of the trees.
Okay.
Yeah, it has the numbers and what they are.
I see numbers.
It has like a full
legend.
Yeah, list of all of
them. Okay, that's interesting.
And, well, whether or not, you know, if they're accurately identified, it's always a question.
I would guess, as I mentioned earlier, that a lot of those trees are hackberries, which are good trees. They're native. A lot of people think they're kind of a weed tree, but I think they're pretty nice. There's probably some red cedar in there. Your typical kind of fence row growth that you see, oftentimes black cherry. From what I saw, it looked like that would be, there might be some elm in there. Hackberry and elm are related. And hackberries are pretty resilient to stress in general.
Mark, if this was approved
to go this way,
the foliage did die,
have to go out this way.
Is there a recourse
that's
that we could set that would require them to replant whatever requirements?
Yeah, they would have to replant to so that the buffer count per 100 linear feet is maintained. And that's why I mentioned earlier that if there was variance granted in this case, that
parking space is going all
with existing and new material as needed, every 100 linear feet would have to be planted or have the plant unit count that would be required for a 35-foot wide buffer.
Okay, so like two or three years down the road, it's still...
If he lost some things, we would have to ensure that it was replanted so that the 35-foot buffer strip width was maintained per 100 linear feet. If that's a condition the board is acceptable with.
I hate it when somebody like that comes in with a proposal like this.
What, Mark, up there in the eastern, northeastern corner, it says pipe and LP.
LP?
It says C-insert, but I don't believe I know what's going on up there.
Area that's very heavily overgrown, I know that. It's, I've looked at it a few times.
Is there a gas easement right there or something? Right down through there?
I'm not sure.
Because I look on down through there and I see LP, LP.
Lonesome Pine.
Hmm?
Lonesome Pine.
You think?
Lonesome Pine. Well, it could be Lonesome Pine. I don't know. It should be a legend. Does it not identify what LP
no,
is?
No, it don't. It's not. It says C insert.
It's,
and
it's retaining wall.
Yeah, I see the retaining wall. But we've got a pipe running down through here. What kind of pipe is this? And if you look down through here, it's right down through here. See? LP, LP, LP.
This is on the survey, so that wall is already existing.
Yeah.
That's what I was talking about.
So overgrown in there.
This area, all this area right through here would not be excavated because it's a lot lower than this property is on the driveway. You look on the topo, all this is substantially lower. It's a natural length of that parking area. It's almost on a natural grade.
Sycamores and cherries.
Yeah, cherries.
That's
a lot of those Spence Row hardwoods.
You look like here at some 910 coming up through here. It's almost on
grain. I know you've shortened it, but you're only talking about this area over here. When you get down into it and go
E,
then you're talking about all of it. But in here,
well, this part is some commercial over here.
Yeah, I see that.
The part
but your title is only talking about this area here. But you're saying the staff would strongly support increasing the buffer along this portion of the property, which is the western portion,
yeah,
which is
that's
over
all this
here.
Down in here.
That's right here.
That's this. Here. This is west over here.
Yeah.
This is east. This is north. This is south.
Right, right.
We got our distances right now. Your directions right. Staff would encourage the applicant to revisit whether this one may be taken under less than a foot of parking areas in 40 even greater protection.
That kind of gets back to Corky's very well stated point is this just a request based on preference? I mean, and that's a very good point. That's kind of the point that I'm alluding to in this, is that every measure been taken to either lessen the amount of variance or nullify the variance that would be needed and still provide protection on the west end. I think it benefits this development to leave as much of the tree cover as they can on the western edge, because that helps buffer it from Campbell Station Road. Yeah, the lower part. And Campbell Station Road has 22,000 trips per day. You know, you want to kind of keep that, the noise and the visual effects of that to a minimum. And I think that it would be good to have the buffer there, but then my question is whether we could maintain a 35-foot buffer, just keep that on the east side by looking at how the parking is laid out and then try to reduce that footprint.
I would say definitely about the parking is that the footprint's not going to, it really won't change, because the way the parking is, you have to have double loads on a driveway, or your parking lot, parking space have become so expensive that you can, it really takes away the feasibility of doing this.
You're providing parking commercial and the residential?
The residential is underground, okay, underneath the buildings.
Okay.
The parking on the that you actually see right there,
up there,
is, would be on the same level as a retail and office. And that parking is real close to the number that was required. Also, that area would be for some visitors, because the parking underneath will be pretty private parking. I mean, that'll be for residents, and they'll have an elevator to go upstairs to their unit. So it won't be for the general public.
Kroger?
Yes. There's the red light down here. This is the red light here. We don't have one here. No, we have one right there.
That's the entry to get
so in. We'd have another one here. They would.
We're not talking about that.
That's not for us.
Campbell Station Road is an access road. That's going to be the main entrance in and out. There'll be a red light there.
Where?
At,
right here?
No. Right there?
The high school entrance, I think, is what he's talking about.
Right turn out? I'm just curious.
You can't. You'd have a general traffic jam.
Well, right now, I'd use it all the time. You can turn left because you have a donut. There's a right here and there's a light here. So when this stops, this traffic, and this stops, this is the way you turn left. But once this road is in, the people that really want to go left would go out here, go to the red light, which will have a left-hand turn, they'll go down this way. If they need to go, if they...
Imagine this at 5 o'clock.
I was just curious. It has nothing to do with this, but
that's
just
not
curious.
Our to do. We're talking about this buffer zone.
Well, that certainly would be something that they'll need to talk about with the rezoning.
Yeah.
I mean, Does anybody have any other questions about
I like the whole idea. I like the plan. I like everything else. I like increasing the environmental. I'm concerned about reducing that other buffer to 20 feet at this point, and I'm concerned about making a variance that runs with the land no matter what it ends up being. And while to some extent we'd be bargaining to get that 90 foot that we could make mandatory and run with the land and always observe and be a buffer, I've always cut off that other side to be 20 feet, which means if this whole thing goes out the window and put in a Taco Bell within 20 feet of the back of the school, whatever it gets rezoned
for.
That's
good point.
Or something. I like the whole thing. I just wish I knew more, and I feel I'm concerned about proceeding at this point.
Mark, if this was to fall through and the land is zoned the way it would be based on the be 20?
Current zoning. Current zoning is, requires a 25-foot buffer office.
So it's not really that much different than 5 feet?
5 feet from what he's requesting in that case.
I don't see an impact at all.
Office, and then it had to come back probably to have some other zoning done to it at some time anyway, or rezoning, I mean.
We've got so many questions here, I'm telling you.
Yeah, it's a complicated one.
Got a lot of ifs.
Five feet is not a lot to get almost 90 feet on the other side. But again, is that a, getting back to Mr. Ives, is that just a preference? Am I being sold the concept that it's nicer and prettier for having this environmental, which happens to also create a green space for the folks who are going to live in this potential area, just on a preference of, I don't care so much about this side's prettier? You know, and is that a legitimate reason? Or is the legitimate reason for the variance that really we're abutting a school that is zoned residential, that's clearly a school and not residential? And does that give us some leeway in it? And I'm not quite sure, but.
That's a tough one, no.
It is.
That's why we pay you guys the big bucks.
Basically, we're losing 5 feet to gain exactly what you said.
From its current zoning, yes, yeah.
So, I like the 90 real well.
Sure, I do too, to be perfectly honest.
A lot of good questions, yeah.
The biggest problem with doing something like this is the first place, I don't think we have the authority to do it. And stick with the guidelines we're given, and we're setting a precedence for every development that comes to town.
It's all good points, yeah.
And it's time that everybody, all the developers, had better get the word that they've got.
That's the point I'm coming to you, that's why you have a board of zoning appeals, is to take it on a case-by-case basis.
I'm taking it on a case-by-case basis, and you do not have an adequate reason for getting a variance. Yours is a personal preference.
Well, guys, if we can speak to, and Craig, if you talk, if you can go to the mic, please.
Variances for a personal preference.
Not a personal preference, it's trying to give.
It's your personal preference as far as the boundaries are going. You want to change the rule. And if you want to, as far as I'm concerned, if you want to build in Farragut, you come in Farragut, and you build according to our rules, not your rule.
I'm going by the rules. I have a plan that will be approved by the rules.
Well, that's your personal preference.
Does anybody have anything else?
None of this has been approved.
Do you have the rules with regard to that?
The traffic study or anything?
Any of this?
No, the only, like I said earlier, that there's been a couple of text amendments that have gone through the planning commission and a land use plan amendment. Yes, and a land use plan amendment that's gone through the planning commission. All those are going to the board of mayor and alderman for final, but they recommended unanimously in favor of it, of those.
I was at that meeting, I listened to this, that's purposely.
Yeah.
Have the rules with regard to when we may grant a variance and for what reason? Usually you have the rules set out. A variance may be granted with these specific things, and that would be helpful to see at this point. Well, I know.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think Mr. Ives makes a good point, and that's kind of what I mentioned in my write-up, is anytime you're looking at granting relief, in this case, it's a buffer, and it's also for a structure setbacks. You got to, let me see if I can find that here. In considering setback relief, which would permit the parking structure to be situated approximately 20 feet inside the peripheral setback line, this, of course, is all assuming it's rezoned to the town center district. A question for the board is whether the applicant has made every effort to lessen the extent of the variance, or are there, or are they simply trying to place more improvements on the property than is appropriate? The staff would agree with the points made by the applicant, but would like to see a smaller footprint of parking, which could provide for both enhanced protection of the environmentally sensitive area and along the western property line, and nullify or lessen further the variance requested along the eastern property line.
I'm actually looking for the state requirement.
Yeah, dealing with, yeah. Let me see if I've got it here in these.
It's kind of a very concise rule. I mean, I recall it being maybe a paragraph, and I think, you know, my memory is that it's tracking what Mr. Ives is.
I'll read it for you. I've got it, because we'll be going over that here in a minute.
Unusual shape of the lot.
All right, here's the wording. This is from the Tennessee Code annotated. It says, where by reason of exceptional narrowness, shallowness, or shape of a specific piece of property at the time of the enactment of the zoning regulation, or by reason of exceptional topographic conditions or other extraordinary and exceptional situation or condition of such piece of property, the strict application of any regulations enacted under this part and part three of this chapter would result in peculiar and exceptional practical difficulties to or exception or undue hardship upon the owner of such property. To authorize upon an appeal related to the property a variance from such strict application so as to relieve such difficulties or hardship, provided such relief may be granted without substantially impairing the intent and purpose of the zoning plan and zoning ordinance. That's a lot of verbiage. But basically, when you're granting a variance, it's you're granting it to some condition inherent in the property itself.
The extraordinary condition would be the trees and the environmental impact.
That's
the only thing I
that's,
could point
that's
to
exactly
that.
Right.
Yep.
That would be something someone could say is an inherent condition in the property that may fall under this language. It's not for personal preference, like Mr. Ives says, and that's what concerns me a little bit. Is I again would like to see the footprint of the parking reassessed to see if there's, you know, a way of, you know, providing for a decent buffer on the west end, and then not needing a variance on the east side. That would be the ideal situation. But if the applicant wants to request to relax from the buffer requirements, then he certainly has the right to do that, and that's what he's trying to do. He's trying to say, this is the plan I want to pursue, and this is the variances that I'm requesting based on this plan.
Look at 25 feet instead of 20, and then you fall right in with what it's zoned as far as the office section.
How badly does that mess you up? Obviously, that'd get us closer to 85 feet approximately on the other side.
That way, if there was a change, if it didn't work.
That way it meets the current zoning
still
buffer.
Have the 25 feet, like what it's zoned for right now. It's zoned for office right now. This piece of property is zoned for office. And
yes.
25 feet.
The buffer strip is 25 feet. So that's right.
Say not 20, but 25. Then we've not set precedence. We've not moved off of what the current zoning is. As far as that.
That's true, and that raises an interesting question. Can we set this variance and then have the zoning subsequently change for the property, which then changes what the setback would? Wouldn't you be right back in the position where you have to come back and get a variance?
Well, that's why you're doing it to the land itself, as
All right.
you mentioned
I mean, so
earlier.
It's going to run with the land no matter what it's zoned at.
Right, that's exactly right.
Okay.
Yeah, you're saying the buffer has to be 90 on the west and 25 on the east?
Well, no,
or... Or is it 85 on the west and 25 on the east, if that's what you're...
Not interested in that, you say?
I'm not interested in reducing the parking at all.
No, I meant moving it to 25 instead of 20.
25 on the east side and...
He said 90. There's not 5 feet there.
No, I understand, but if you took about 85 feet on the one side and about 25 feet on the other, you still got the same amount. Is that going to mess you up terribly?
As long as the parking footprint is as it is today, what is approved, you know, will work, yeah.
All you'd be doing would be moving it west 5 feet, everything.
I would be agreeable based on the extraordinary condition and amenable to approving a variance, and I would so move to approve a variance where it's 25 feet on the side with the school, which I guess is the east side, and
no.
Approximately 85 feet on the Campbell Station side, which is the west side, noting that the variance would be granted because of the extraordinary condition of the environmental conditions that exist on the one side, and noting the fact that, in fact, the other side is not a residential, it's a school, and that the overall goal is that it's going to run with the land. No one's going to be able to build within that 85 approximately foot buffer from here to eternity, I guess, without another variance at some point.
The only, and one thing to be clear about is, as I mentioned earlier, this affects setbacks too. So are you also granting relief? You can have a buffer strip and then you can still have a 40 foot setback for structures. Well, I'm just saying it needs to be clear that
we either do it or we don't do it.
That peripheral setback, instead of being 40 if he rezones it to town center district, would be 25 instead of what he originally requested is 20. So he'd be encroaching 15 feet into the peripheral setback and 5 feet or 10 feet into the buffer strip that's required for town center district. So there's a couple of things that going on with that. You've got the buffer, then you also have a setback that is interrelated, but they're different. Be clear on your motion, or I can help you with it if I understand what it is.
Grant this variance.
As requested? Okay. And that would affect the buffer and the peripheral setback, as that's what's been requested. So y'all understand that. Well, the request is would affect the required buffer strip and also this is assuming it's rezoned to town center district, but it's going to go with the land, is that your setback for structures would also be lessened in addition to the buffer strip. That's the request. In other words, you can put, in the case of this development, that parking garage to, as requested, to within 20 feet of the eastern property line, even though the required setback is 40 feet without relief.
Even though on the drawing it's marked 35.
Well, the buffer strip is 35 feet, but if they develop that property and it's rezoned the town center district, they'll and there's no change in the setbacks, then the structures will have to be 40 feet off of the peripheral property lines. Does that make sense? No motion. We'll, if y'all need to take a minute break.
Look at both of these in. Miss yours? Okay. Sorry.
With you all, I was going to have a little training session in the back because I've got some materials back there. Yeah.
Okay.
That's okay.
Did you bring dinner?
I move we adjourn.
Okay. Very good.
I second it.
I'm going to mention a couple of training sessions.